everyone. Welcome back to integralcalc.com. We're going to be doing another example today of interval of convergence. The sum that we have today is 5 to the n times x to the n divided by the quantity n factorial. So as with any interval of convergence problem, the first thing that we're going to do is everywhere where we see n in our original function, we're going to substitute n plus 1. And we're going to divide that whole thing by the original function. So you can see here in the top half of our fraction, we've substituted everywhere n plus 1 for n. And then we divide that whole thing by our original function here. So once we've done that, once we've set it up, and by the way, we're taking the limit as n approaches infinity always. So once we set that up, now it's just a matter of simplifying what's inside these absolute value brackets. So the way that we're going to do that first is instead of dividing by this entire fraction, we're going to multiply the top fraction by the inverse of the bottom fraction instead of dividing. So we flip this fraction on its head, and we have this n factorial in the numerator and the 5 to the n times x to the n in the denominator, and we're multiplying instead of dividing. Next step in our simplification process, I'm going to rearrange these fractions since everything's multiplied together, I can do that, and I'm going to put this n plus 1 factorial and the n factorial together, and then this 5 to the n plus 1 times x to the n plus 1 divided by 5 to the n times x to the n, I'm putting those together because it's going to make it easier to simplify, as you'll see next. So right now I'm going to try to tackle, for simplification purposes, this first fraction here, this n factorial divided by the quantity n plus 1 factorial. And the way that I'm going to do that, just to illustrate how this simplifies, if we substitute a random number, in this case we'll say 4 for n, right? So we substitute 4 for n. 4 factorial is 4 times 3 times 2 times 1, which we have in the numerator, which means that in the denominator we would have 4 plus 1, which would be 5, so we'd have 5 factorial, and you'd have 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. So you can see that no matter what number we pick for n here, we're going to end up, all of these terms in the numerator are going to cancel with every term in the denominator except this first one here. So all that's going to remain is 5, or 1 over 5. So that means that everything in the numerator here is going to cancel, and we're just going to be left with n plus 1, no factorial, just n plus 1, in the denominator. So I'm going to go ahead and change this first fraction to be 1 divided by n plus 1, which is the simplification of that fraction there. Now we're going to go ahead and tackle this second fraction here. And the way that we do that is with the following method. So remember that when you have a fraction and you have something in the both in the numerator and the denominator with the same base. In other words, here we have 5 raised to an exponent and 5 raised to an exponent in the numerator and denominator. We also have n raised to some exponent in the numerator and n raised to some exponent in the denominator. So those are like bases. The 5 and 5 and the x and x, they have the same base, just different exponents. When that's the case, you can subtract the exponent in the denominator from the exponent in the numerator. So in our case, we have n plus 1 in the numerator, and so we're going to subtract from that just the n in the denominator. Well, n plus 1 minus n just gives you 1, which means that everything in our denominator is going to cancel, and we're just going to be left with 5x in the numerator. So we've simplified now our two fractions. And now what we're going to do is go ahead and pull out this 5x. And the reason that we can do that is because we're taking the limit as n approaches infinity. So all that matters for what's inside our absolute value brackets here is anything that's related to n. So this 5x part we can remove. Because it was inside absolute value brackets, we have to keep it inside absolute value brackets. So it stays inside absolute value brackets out here. And then we're multiplying by the limit as n approaches infinity of this 1 divided by n plus 1. So now that we've done that, we can go ahead and plug in infinity for n, because we've simplified enough that we can just plug in infinity easily. And you see that we end up with 1 divided by infinity plus 1. In other words, 1 divided by infinity. Now, 1 divided by infinity is going to give us 0, right? Because when you take 1 and you divide it by a huge number, that's going to give you a very, 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 very tiny number close to 0, which means that the limit as n approaches infinity is going to become 0. It's going to approach 0. So this whole second part here, this limit as n approaches infinity of this whole function, this is all going to become 0. And we're going to be left with the absolute value of 5x times 0, which of course is going to equal 0. So normally these interval of convergence problems end up being longer. We would set this, you know, something like 5x to be less than 1, and we would move on with our interval of convergence. However, it's important to illustrate, and this is why I wanted to do this example, whenever you end up with the 0 after you take this limit here, it means that the interval of convergence is all real numbers, which looks like this, our final answer. The interval of convergence is all real numbers, so everything from negative infinity to positive infinity. So whenever you end up with 0 at this step, this here interval of convergence, negative infinity to positive infinity, is going to be our final answer. So just keep that in mind when you end up with this in this step. This is going to be your final answer. You don't need to go further to test endpoints or anything like that. So I hope that helped you guys, and I'll see you in the next video.